Before I came to Japan to pursue tertiary education, I lived in Cebu, Philippines for 12 years. Here's an overview of the city. Metro Cebu is the second most populated urban area in the Philippines with 3.2 million people. Its population is expected to grow to 5 million by 2050. The city is sandwiched between the mountains and the sea, leaving a limited amount of flat land. This area, where most of Cebu's flat land is located, when measured on Google Maps, is about 170 square kilometers. Assuming almost all of the 5 million would live here, this area would have a population density of about 30,000 per square kilometer. This would easily put it in the current top 10 most densely populated cities in the world. This density certainly isn't gonna be consistent over the area, as it is over 35 kilometers from end to end, so the population would be concentrated around the center. Excluding arterial roads, the streets of Cebu are very narrow, with a lot of one-way streets. This is especially true in the historic downtown. Four or six-lane roads are even considered standard for arterial roads. The current infrastructure will not be able to handle this many people. If more people opt to live outside the 170 square kilometer area, either further north or south, or in the mountains, it would put a bigger strain on the roads as they go into the city, especially on the few coastal or mountain roads. The city's historic downtown is on Colon Street, which is the oldest street in the Philippines. However, in the 21st century, a lot of the activity has shifted towards other important business districts, such as the area around the Fuente Osmeña, Cebu Business Park, and IT Park. These places are home to most of the high-rise buildings in Cebu. These nodes of development are the perfect distances apart for rail transit, which means it is sensible to connect these destinations by train. Currently, there's no rapid transit you can use to get past the congestion. The BRT's construction only commenced last year after many years of delays. Although this project will be a big improvement for Cebu's public transport system, at some point it will not be enough. So while I was in high school, I created a rail system plan in preparation for that time, not just to alleviate Cebu's traffic, but also to support Cebu's economic development in an environmentally friendly manner. Cebu's rail system will consist of three subway lines, plus a suburban rail line and a tram system. The first line is the Red Line or the Loop Line. It will run under a four-lane arterial road and pass through very important destinations with high-rise buildings. Banilad, IT Park, and Ayala, which is named after a nearby major mall and is located in Cebu Business Park, an important business district. The line continues towards the capital, Osmeña, and San Antonio, where there is a transfer with a suburban line. The line then enters the historic downtown in Colon before going under Mactan Strait. The tracks surface in a shallow section of the Mactan Strait and runs elevated on Mactan Island. The current empty land will suddenly have easy access to the downtown, which will allow new developments to pop up. The line goes back underground and stops at MEPS 2, an important industrial center, and Mactan Cebu International Airport. Then, the line turns around to Pusok and Lapu-Lapu City Hall before returning to Cebu Island. The line will pass through Mandaue City with a transfer on the Blue Line and the regional train at Mandaue Station. The line continues under AS Fortuna Street before returning to Banilad. This line, especially the section between Banilad and Colon, will likely be the first line to be built as it connects very important destinations. Moving on, the Blue Line starts from Talisay and runs elevated over the road. It will not be the first section to be completed, not only because there aren't many notable places in this section, but also because the suburban line, which runs under this road, needs to be completed first depending on the construction method. The section east of Mambaling will be completed earlier than the section to the west of it. The line will run under a road which is two lanes at a certain segment, so this requires demolishing some buildings. This will be used as an opportunity for the line to go underground, which allows this land acquisition to hit two birds with one stone. The line will connect to the loop line at Colon. Then, it runs under the North Reclamation Area, where it connects with the major malls of Robinson's Galleria and SM City Cebu. The next stop is Gatewalk, which is named after a nearby under-construction high-density development. There will also be a mall that will open nearby. The stop after that is Mandani Bay, another under-construction high-rise development. Then, it goes through Mandaue City Hall, before terminating at Mandaue Station. The last line is the Yellow Line, which starts in Talisay on the Blue Line. The line connects to SRP, a reclaimed piece of land that has Chitti de Mare, an under-construction mixed-use development, and SMC Side, Cebu's largest mall and the fourth largest mall in the Philippines. Then, the line goes underground, connecting to the Blue Line again at Mambaling. The line makes stops at populated communities like Tisa and Guadalupe before merging with the loop line at the capital. At Banilad, the loop line branches off and the yellow line continues on the same road, stopping at the University of San Carlos. The line enters the Talamban area, which is some small hills with opportunities for the line to go above ground with minimal space. The line is now elevated, stopping at Talamban, Tigbao, Bacayan, and Pitos. One bonus line I put is the Orange Line, which forms a loop around Mactan Island. It would have a lower capacity compared to the subway lines. It would be similar to systems like the Vancouver SkyTrain and the London DLR. Aside from subways, there will also be a suburban line which has lower frequencies, but uses larger trains with higher capacities and speeds, with only Mabolo, San Antonio, possibly later renamed to Cebu, and Mambaling as the stops in between Mandaue and Talisay. It would be entirely underground in this section. The railway will serve cities and towns further away, such as Liloan, Consolacion, and Naga. This line will decrease the time it takes for cities further out to access Cebu City. On some sections, especially where the road is wide and straight, it can be constructed using cotton cover, but in other parts, it will use a tunnel boring machine to freely run below buildings and utilities. Even after this extensive network is built out, there's still a lot of places that aren't covered by rail. To give those places access, there will be a tram network, colored purple on the map, which will mostly run on the road. Transfers with the subway or suburban train may not be optimal, but going from the tram stop to the final destination will be easier as it is on the surface and the distances between the tram stops are short. There will be three routes. The T1 starts at Cebu's historic downtown, loops around in Cebu Business Park, then heads back to the downtown. T2 starts at Gatewalk and loops around in Cebu Business Park like T1. On any of the stops on the shared Cebu Business Park loop, passengers can transfer between T1 and T2. T3 will connect Lahug and IT Park to SM City Cebu and crosses over the T2. It can also be extended to Mactan Island, although this would be the last section to be built as it requires crossing water. Let me talk about some of the design features of the system. Unlike the trains in Manila, which are almost fully elevated, the trains of Cebu will go underground in the dense parts of the city. This minimizes the need to expand the road to accommodate pillars. Being in a city prone to flooding, the station entrances will need to be raised so that the water will not enter the system. The system is also routed along major roads, which allows for the use of a construction method called cut and cover, which, as the name suggests, will excavate the road, build a tunnel, and fill the top back in. Although this causes a lot of disruption, it is cheaper and faster to build than using a tunnel boring machine, and the stations will be shallow and more quickly accessible. This also hits two birds with one stone as it allows the reconstruction of drainage and utilities under the road during the construction, which is important as the city often floods. It can even be used as an opportunity to bury overhead electrical wires, which would make them more resistant to the natural disasters the country is vulnerable to. The suburban railway requires a tunnel boring machine on a significant portion, but this will allow for a straighter track and higher speeds because of the freedom of the tunnel boring method. On elevated portions of the subway that run over the road, the beams take up some space. The beams will take up the middle of the road and turn the four-lane road into a two-lane road. But it will leave a lot of space, which can be used to widen the sidewalks, as currently, many sidewalks are dangerously narrow despite running along arterial roads. On the section of the yellow line north of Talamban, there are less structures, so the subway will be elevated, but not exactly aligned to the road right-of-way. One thing to note is that these alignments don't have to be followed exactly. Should the planners decide that they're willing to expropriate more properties, they can switch some underground sections to elevated rail, reducing the construction costs. Another measure put into the design is making the trains high-floored. While the stations are more expensive to build, the benefits outweigh them because the equipment needed to operate the train is under the floor together with the wheels rather than inside the cabin or on the roof. This lowers the center of gravity and frees up space. This is why Manila's high-floored LRT2 trains have higher capacities and 5 doors on each side of the car, while the lower-floored LRT1 and MRT3 have all their passengers crammed into 1 or 2 doors per car. Yes, lower-floored trains have their purposes, especially as a local means of transport like in the tram network or the Orange Line, but not as the backbone of a city. Finally, the transfers are seamless. Transfers between the lines should not be like in Manila where passengers have to walk hundreds of meters or go up and down the stairs just to transfer. To fix this, the busy Manila to Capital corridor features cross-platform transfers where people can walk across the platform to transfer. In IT Park and Ayala, passengers can transfer to the other line in the same direction, while in Banilad and the Capital, they can transfer to the other line but in the opposite direction. This gives the best possible transfer experience on trips between any point on the red and yellow lines. This is inspired by the interchanges of Hong Kong and Singapore, widely regarded as having the best public transit systems in existence. If the red and yellow lines share tracks, the transfer will still be convenient as they will use the same platforms. On other transfers, the lines will be on top of each other, meaning you only need to take the escalator from one floor to the other to transfer lines. The trams will have convenient transfers as well. Because the loop in the Cebu Business Park is shared, you can transfer trams on the same platform. The transfer between the T2 and T3 will be underground, which allows the passengers to transfer without crossing the road. As you have seen, there are some stations that are in currently empty space that can be developed. These are not the only places where development can happen though. It can happen in a 46-hectare area bound by Serio Osmeña Boulevard, V. Soto Street, MJ Cuenco Avenue, and General Maxilom Avenue. The streets inside will be converted to one-way streets with low speed limits arranged in a way that only the people going into and outside the area use it, and all through traffic will be forced to use the main roads surrounding the area. An exception will be T. Padilla Street, which will have a 350-meter flyover to keep the ground level undisturbed. With the absence of car traffic, within the boundaries will be a pedestrian and cycle-friendly community. A lot of the extra space previously used to accommodate cars will be freed for trees, which cool the area and make the area pleasant. People living here can safely walk or cycle to their daily needs, as it is a mixed-use development, putting houses and shops in close proximity. On the eastern corner is the currently underutilized mall, Robinson's Galleria, which will be easily accessible. It will be served by 2 blue lines on the southern side and trams on the eastern side, allowing easy access to different places in Cebu. Mandaue and Mambaling will be big stations, each with 2 subway lines and the suburban train running through them. The stations can't fit under or over the roads that run through them, meaning there will be a lot of land expropriation. This is especially true in Mandaue, which is a potential terminal station for switching back or through running, which will require more platforms. However, the stations being large hubs makes the areas valuable for real estate, so there will be many tall buildings springing up in the previously demolished areas, and the station buildings can have many shops and services. Near Mandaue Station is SM City J Mall, which would be easily accessible to the residents of the development. On the Red Line, Tigbao, Bacayan, and Pit-O stations will be on empty spaces. These spaces will have mid-rise apartments. Aside from the apartments that will be built near the stations, existing houses and schools will also be significant sources of ridership in this area, such as the large Villa Laison subdivision near Bacayan. However, there are also places that are in close proximity to stations but aren't accessible due to the lack of bridges over the Butuanon River. These places will be connected by a pedestrian and bike bridge. This would be more environmentally friendly and cheaper to build and maintain than vehicle roads while transporting more people. It's not just train stations that will have major developments, but tram stops as well. The intersection between T2 and T3 would be valuable as well, as anyone living there can get to IT Park, Cebu Business Park, and SM City Cebu on one tram, and to downtown Cebu on two, so we can expect some development to occur in the area. This may be the first transit-oriented development, as the low-cost tram network is likely the first one that will get built. And that's it for my urban railway plans for Cebu. With this, the transport situation in Cebu will significantly improve, from a city that's slow to travel around to a city where you can get to most of the important destinations quickly and conveniently using an environmentally friendly mode of transport. If you have some questions or suggestions, make sure to leave them down in the comment section, and thanks for watching.